Of course, these podcasts are sponsored by Yak Attack, yakattack.us. Yak Attack is the leader in the kayak fishing industry who specializes in kayak fishing rigging solutions. As kayak anglers themselves, they are tightly integrated into the kayak fishing community and are acutely aware of what the sport needs. It all starts off with gear track and or the mighty mount. The gear track comes in all different sizes and colors, and the screw ball that attaches to it connects everything to your boat. What that is a variety of rod holders and camera mounts for your still cameras and your GoPros. Your light poles with the day flags that folds into the flags. Fish finder mounts and your black pack crate system. All of Yak Attack's products are made in the USA. A few years ago, Yak Attack set the gold standard in kayak visibility with the Visi Carbon Pro. Fast forward to today and it remains the most dependable light flag combination in the industry. The 48-inch deployed height against the flag and the light up where it can be seen. The 14-inch collapse length lets it stow away when it's not in use. The high visibility flag doubles as a pouch, making it easy to pack away in the store. The expected lamp life of 10,000 plus hours on the ultra bright high efficient LEDs and at least 100 hours from the three AA batteries that are included. The carbon fiber mast is strong and lightweight, and the narrow profile offers low wind drag. The soft foam keeps it afloat, and it fits into most rod holders. Available in an array of mounting options that fits just about all boats and popular mounts, don't compromise with safety. Depend on what tens of thousands of other paddlers trust. There is only one Visi Carbon Pro. These podcasts are also sponsored by my DVDs at kayakkevin.com. The Kayak Fishing Chesapeake Bay series, and the Bay Tour DVD. The Kayak Fishing DVDs are broken up into a trilogy. Number one is the intro into our fishery, which has a full year's worth of footage for more of the larger fish targets in the lower Chesapeake Bay. The instructional sequels are broken up into two parts, the warm water and the cold water species. Number two is the warm water species with detailed instruction on the rigs and the fishery itself, spanning from the red drum at the shoals, flounder in the summer, and the summer structure species around the bridge, and sight casting the red drum and striper. Number three is the cold water species, with detailed instructions and how-to of the fisheries of the winter targets, tautog and the eastern shore striper fishery. The Chesapeake Bay Tour DVD is a six-week, 600-mile tour I did around in 2010 around the Chesapeake Bay, filmed in kind of a Survivor Man style, showing everything I do and look for when I'm on a long-distance tour. All of these DVDs are available at kayakkevin.com. My DVDs at kayakkevin.com and Yak Attack at yakattack.us. All right, it's podcast number 63. It is August 5th, 2015.
How late are we?
Half hour.
Half hour. That's not bad. That's normal. That's average, actually.
That's average.
7:30-ish means 8.
Not my fault. I was here at 7:30.
That's right.
Yeah. We got Kendall Osborne. He's a fly fisherman around the area. He's been a good friend of mine for a long time. I think I probably met you when I did seminars, right?
Yes.
So I met you early on when I was doing seminars, and we fish together. You fish out of your boat, and we fish out of the kayaks in the springtime. We communicate to each other. That one video where you said,
my boat's cruising right in on us.
Yeah, and I was like,
Is that your boy? Yeah. And you're like, yep.
That was Kendall.
Kendall had already called him on the phone. No, that wasn't the Four Reds. That was the day we were smoking them with Underwood.
Right.
That was the day we were smoking them with Underwood. Right. Underwood caught the striper that day.
Yeah. He's the Virginia Coastal Fly Angler, right?
It's a local club.
It's a local club.
Fly fishing mostly saltwater, but freshwater also.
And it's vcfa.org. Virginia Coastal Fly Anglers.org.
Yeah, and we have a Facebook page too.
If
you search for Virginia Coastal Fly Anglers, you'll get that.
Easy enough. And we got Lee.
I was wondering if you were going to remember that because you kept going on with the story. I was wondering if you were still introducing. I'm here, and I'm the reason we're late this time. Kevin's been screaming at me since I got here because all I want to do is talk about fishing. Done fishing.
And it's, of course, as soon as Kendall gets in, I'm setting up. So did you fish today? I'm like, fuck. Yes. No. Stop. And I was like, it's the whole thing. It's the hardest thing about this podcast the most difficult thing is at the beginning, trying not to get into the conversation that we're about ready to try to get into, and that was the whole purpose of us being in there and videoing it. But it's so natural for us to get going immediately.
Right.
So it's hard to, yeah, so sorry. So
yeah.
we had to small talk ourselves to death before.
Right.
But we started getting into some shit, and actually when we were talking about some shit was actually stuff that we could have, you know, got on with the podcast anyway, but...
Yeah, we talk about everything on here. Like the other night.
Yeah,
if,
me, you were talking.
If you ever watched the other night, we had the fights going on here on the UFC. We're watching UFC fights on here. We can't have the volume or anything because like copyright types of things. But we were watching the fights, and in between the fights and rounds, we'd talk about fishing, and then the fights would come back on, and we'd be just sitting there watching. Ooh, you know. It was fun. I don't know how much fun it was for the people watching it, but it was a lot of fun for us to do that.
Yeah. Yeah, it was, what, 37 seconds?
Oh, Rousey?
Oh, we didn't do that. Oh, that shit. 34 seconds.
That was super late night. That shit's late.
Yeah,
yeah, everybody saw it, but yeah. I buy them all. And I watch it late. That was a boring card. They slipped into like local guys fighting each other basically for a title, for the Ultimate Fighter title, whatever. Two weight classes. There's two extra fights on this card that I don't know who these people are. So I kind of took a nap. I just laid on my floor just to get some rest, and then got back up again for the Shogun and Shogun fight, and then the last one.
But what about that same night? There were several other fights that same night.
Yeah,
the Diaz brothers got into it with Khabib Nurmagomedov at the World Series of Fighting,
and Paul Harris
tried to rip a guy's arm off after like. I mean, there's no more tapping that could have been involved there.
History with that guy.
Yeah, right. He's a dickhead.
He holds on to submissions until the guys pull him off. You can't just go stop.
They're tapping him. The referee's tapping him. The guy is tapping him, and he's just twerking on the guy. I mean, was it Jake? Was it Jake something?
Jake Shields
punched him as he got up. Yeah. I mean, he literally came up out of the submission.
He said he was also eye gouging him during the fight too.
Yeah, Pajares is so. Anyway, that was a title fight. They stripped him of the title.
Yeah, that was going to happen. He got kicked out of the UFC for it because he was holding on to it. And the submissions that he's holding are like knee-ripping, ankle-twisting.
This was a shoulder twist, but it was going to tear the guy in the guy's
injuries career. that would stop you for like 2 years, you know, and take these, you know, high-end guys out and they're tapping already, you know. And but the thing is that the guy's like from the hills, poor as shit in Brazil, you know, and they say he's kind of just a dimwit. He hurts everybody. The only person he doesn't hurt in the gym is his brother, and he just hurts everybody. He just kind of one of these dumb guys, just crank and can't stop. He just.
But anyway, so the Diaz brothers went at Khabib
And those guys are just fighters, man. That's all those guys are.
Right.
Just period.
Right.
Just fighting at the...
Like, if we don't need that octagon, I think I can beat you up. So we both train every day.
What I heard is, why were they sitting next to each other? And was the WSOF put them close to each other for that?
Right.
Because they were...
Because Khabib just missed a fight with Cowboy, right?
But one of the Diaz brothers also wanted to fight him. So it's been an ongoing thing.
It's got to be Nick. Yeah. Nick is the one that fights in that weight class, right?
55.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, Nate.
Nate.
No. It is Nate. 55, yeah. Because Nick is the one who just fought Silva.
Right.
At 185. Yeah. Yeah. Laid down. Okay. No, about the fights.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we talk
off
about
topic.
That's how it goes.
That's how it goes. We talk about everything. My fishing stories are shorter this week.
All right. You want?
Well, see, last Thursday, we didn't go last Thursday. Last Thursday, Jay and I went with Brian. We went out into the ocean, and we caught 3 cobias. I took my buddy Thomas, it would be awesome to get him on the podcast, except he drove back to Illinois today. This is the coolest thing. Thomas went on one of the skunk trips. Brian rarely ever gets skunked, and I feel really bad when I go with him and he gets skunked because I feel like I'm terrible luck, you know what I mean? So anyway, my buddy Thomas went, and we saw a lot of fish that day and just couldn't get anything to eat at all.
Yeah.
You know, so we didn't catch anything that day. So Thomas tells me he's moving, you know, moving back or whatever, and he works for one of those contract companies for the government. He's an engineer, but he works for those companies that works off government contracts, and they come up every few years. Anyway, the company he's working, he doesn't like where they're headed. You know what I mean? He doesn't like having to move every 2 weeks around and have his stuff based here in Norfolk, but every 2 or 3 weeks, or 2 or 3 months, depending on how long the job is, he's at a different area. And then he's back here for a couple weeks. He hated it. So he took this opportunity to leave. He's going back to Illinois. So in his last few days here, I was like, man, I got the opportunity last Thursday to get out and take him in the afternoon with Brian and Jay. Mm-hmm. And it didn't take very long. And he caught one about 44 inches or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, the first one. And then we got moving along and Jay caught one. Jay caught one on a Ronzi up the side of the boat. And Brian screams, all of them are following it. Lee, if you can't catch one of these fish, you're the worst fisherman ever. So I throw the bucktail just right past him, and it doesn't take 2 seconds, and there's just an explosion, and my rod's going off. And he's like, dude, that was too easy. You're still the worst fisherman ever. He's like, that's too easy. So we caught. I handed the rod to Thomas. 54.1.
Damn.
Almost a citation.
Right.
Almost got him a citation, man.
But,
inches. Cobia.
Inches.
No.
Pounds.
Okay. Pounds. 54.1
pounds.
55 pounds, 50 inches.
50 inches.
It was definitely a really citation, but we...
Yeah.
He was like, nah, man.
Dinner.
Yeah. He's a big, giant, Thor-looking dude.
Right.
So... And he's from Illinois. So he's like, dude, these fish are amazing. He sends this picture to everyone he knows, you know what I mean, on the phone, as soon, well, like while we're out there.
They don't have fish like that in Illinois.
Right. Yeah. No, so we caught three that day. A pair of nice fish that had other ones with them. But the first time Jay's fish came up and I tried to pitch the eel out next to his fish, it dove so fast the other one didn't even have time to register that there was a bait that hit the water.
Right, just
otherwise, it was the first time it came up. I think we would have had a good shot. We already had two on. I think we would have had a really good shot of getting the third one on. But the fish just dove so fast because they were coming up and it was underneath, just like you want them to be. Just underneath the other one that's hooked. And he'll see that eel, man, and he'll just come up and blast it and go the other way for some reason. Like, he's trying to steal it from the one that's hooked, you know? So,
yeah.
And then... I didn't get out in the kayak last week. Last Friday sucked. I really, really want to go fish for spadefish and sheep's head. Billy caught a sheep's head. Tex caught some nice spades.
Yeah.
I really want to get out and do that. The current is terrible and the wind is bad right now, except for today.
The current is the reason why I went camping this week, because I knew the bridge was going to suck. I
mean, yeah.
When I drove across, it looked all right because we
probably slapped. There's cobias in the area where we paddle.
I know, and that's, it's this time of year. It's August.
There's cobias in there, man.
Yep. I saw somebody, when I was driving across, unhooking a gaff and, you know, taking
Billy
the gaff
and them
away.
Billy and them saw a guy catch one.
I didn't see where it was, but I could see him working. You know,
we were not right on the bridge, but we weren't, like, really, really far away and caught one today pretty close to that area.
Cool.
And it had a bigger one with it. I threw my first cast was behind him. But it was the first cast of the day, you know what I mean? And they were just cruising. So, not a real big deal. I mean, it was quick, got it back. The second cast, right in front of them, and the little one just... Pew! Wham! And Jay's like, dude, that's the shark that's on that big cobia. I was like, nah, dude, that's not a cobia. We've been seeing them with sharks.
Huh.
Little sharks. Yeah. Hear them.
Sharks with them or them with sharks?
I don't know.
Who's in front?
Yeah.
Normally the sharks are in front.
Okay.
And they're little tiny ones too, which is insane. But but the sharks do like crazy circles and all kinds of stuff, and the cobia swim straight, and the sharks are like, you know what I mean?
Right.
But so I came down, I handed the rod down to Megan, she reeled the fish in, I gaffed it. As soon as I gaffed the fish and started to clean the boat out, because because I fished with Rick for so long, as soon as I kill a fish, it's time to get the blood out. There he is! Get up here! There he is, Lee! Come on! I gotta climb back up, and the other one has popped back up. It's gotta be the same one. You know what I mean? Other one has popped back up. Nice. Looks like close to a weight citation fish. You know what I mean? A nice fish. And it's just swimming away just as pretty as you want, man. And we throw three just amazing casts right in front of it. And it watched its buddy take that gaff from the deep and was like, yeah, no, I don't want any of that. So we got moving along and found one on a buoy after that, a little nicer than the one we caught. We caught, the one Zach had was probably 35 pounds or so. The one Megan caught was probably 25 pounds or so. You know, not bad. We saw some other fish that we couldn't get to get good shots on, and then I threw a perfect shot in front of one with a bucktail, and it got right in front of his face, and he just made this big giant eruption and went the other way. Scared to death. Scared to death. I mean, the cast was 10 feet past him, just bucktail skips, 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 and the fish just, I mean, the kicks his tail, the water splashes, obviously, man, but he just went the other way. Didn't even, nope, that is not me.
He just spooked him, he just all of a sudden came into a
side. It came to him, he was swimming towards it. It came to him and it got next to him and he was like, nope, see ya. That's not what I want. I don't know, the two other ones I put it perfectly in front of ate, and then, the big one didn't after we caught his buddy, but yeah, I don't know. So we didn't get shots on two, and one of them was just scared. Yeah. That was a decent fish too. Not a small fish at all. Not a giant, but definitely not small enough to be scared by a bucktail.
Yeah. All right. And so what? And then today?
That was today.
That was today. Yeah.
That was today.
Yeah.
With Zach and Megan and Jay.
Cool. Yep. Yeah. Well, that's why I went camping this week. Because
the current's insane.
Yeah, I was like, it's not even that fun on the bridge when it's a knot, over a knot and a half or a knot, right. Whatever it's going to be. And those slack currents are so small,
right.
It's just, those are real turnarounds. So I went, I just saw a window to go camping. And I've been camping in the bay, so I went camping on the other side. And it's been 2 years since I've camped on that side.
It's just a lot of bugs over there, man.
No. It was windy as fuck.
Okay.
Bugs are everywhere. I don't worry about bugs. It's just, it's been easier there. Because that's a whole different environment.
Over there.
It's a whole different environment in Oceanside. It's all just a different environment.
Completely different.
Especially, I went from camping on these little beaches and little islands to an almost vast, fucking vast sand land,
Right.
It's huge. So, and the way I had that middle, high tide in the middle of the day, so I had to, current in and then midway and then current out to the spot, to the island. And I got there and kind of landed and the current was going out pretty good, and I was looking at shoals over here, and there's a really beautiful structure out there. Lee, I'll tell you, I'll tell you where I went, right? Tell you where I went? Okay. Yeah. So beautiful structure out front. And I land and I come around front and I start looking, and I'm like, it's too windy. The wind, it was a tailwind there, so it was awesome. And once I got there, it really started picking up from the southwest and just kept on. It blew all night.
Right.
Even today, it blew more than earlier than it was supposed to. I had to paddle in with it.
Yeah.
But so I get there and I pull my boat up and look for a spot look for a spot and draw my arrows. And okay, I'm gonna go fish around here. So I just start walking and casting. And it was a cool structure. I'm just going to draw this the way the front, just because the whole finding, when I saw the structure, I was like, there's got to be reds here. I mean, this is reds territory, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm walking around and I'm making casts, and I'm looking here. And I'm in knee deep. The breaker's right here. I'm looking right here, just where I'm usually looking, because that's where I've been looking before. All using all my knowledge from the surf. Now, I'm a shore fisherman at this point, right? So I didn't know kayak fishing this weekend. It was all from the beach. And this weekend, my last 2 days.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Your weekend.
Yeah, my weekend.
Right.
And, yeah. And
my weekend is Thursday and Friday.
Yeah.
Today was my Friday, and I went fishing.
And today's my...
So tomorrow's my Saturday on Thursday.
Today's my Sunday.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't get to fish together very much anymore.
No. So I'm making casts, and I'm, lobbing out, and I'm dragging, and there's a shoal, and there's a slough, and then there's another shoal point, and then there's a real... I'm gonna draw it because it's hard to explain. I can explain it to you, but you'll know once you see what I'm talking about. The beach, and then here, and then it carves in, and there's a whole big giant fucking structure over there. I walked around this place at low tide. It was amazing. I mean, just 6 foot drop, shoo, the holes and just channels, and then there's 12 foot deep channels, and it's already low tide. There's overhead right there. It was crazy.
That's one of those fucking 9 foot stingrays are digging holes,
yeah.
Bro.
No, these are current rays.
Yeah, I'm
man,
just messing with you.
Yeah, yeah. So there's a shoal outside here, which joined up to here, And then there was, this was deep water, and there was current running through this way, right? So here's the beach, here's the shoal outside, and connected to this point. So there's a little point here, and there's all kinds of little stuff. But there's so here's the shoal outside here. So I landed here because I was going to camp on the edge, you know, and outside from everywhere else. And I was like, so I started walking. And I get to right at this one. And there's a little teeny connection here. There's like little point right here. And then it opens up a little bit. And I'm making a cast. As soon as I lob one out, here comes one. Right at my feet. I'm like, shit. Yeah, I'm like, just trying to reel up as fast as I can. No, 30.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So the small...
The ones that are here.
The ones were catching, right, ones, right, yeah, but not, yeah, not...
No, not giants. Okay, no. No, I did take
because you never know out...
I took my cobia rod for anything big.
Right.
Including what he targets.
Right.
So I see one right here. I'm like, good, they're here. This is awesome. I'm fishing. This is this whole area. This is me. This is complete. I know what this is. So then I paddle around.
And then the alligators show up.
And I try to do some side casting, but the water's too murky on that side. It's sandy, churny. And so I paddle around, and I finally land again and just start walking again. And then this is my area, man. I mean, you got current, drop-off, you know, slough, shoal. I mean, it's
so
just
there's
too
some
much,
slick water,
man.
Some, and then you got, yeah.
Yeah, so yeah. I mean, so I even at low tide walked across to this shoal and, you know, walked around, cast to here. But I'm standing here, and again, as soon as that one lands, here he comes. Just move it.
You didn't back up.
I'm like,
shit! You just be casting parallel to your feet.
Well, that's what I was doing. I would go out and cast the beach, cast short, and I was just casting short, and I was just at that point just casting longs to getting longs. You know, I was doing short casts because I'm right here usually, but I can't see shit, so I'm gonna walk out here.
Right.
So, and this one I actually get in front of him, and then he does one of these turns and just doesn't see it, right? So I'm like, damn, they're here. They are here. And man, this is last night, so it's getting, I gotta set up my tent and all that stuff. So at least I have my spot, right? So I can just camp out right here. I'm right in the middle of it all.
So you went fishing today?
I caught one this morning. Yeah, and so out from the beach, and it was windy this morning again. Last night there was a storm that was north, and I wasn't sure if it was coming in on us or.
You didn't have a radio, weather radio?
No, not shit.
Accomack County, tornado warning.
Yeah,
they had like a touchdown in Accomack somewhere or something.
Yeah, I saw it. It kept me up all most of the night. I was like, is this coming this way? Because it looked like it was bellowing south, but it looked like it was also moving east, and the top was east. But I wasn't sure if it was expanding and how close it was going to get, but the light show was intense. I mean, it was keeping me up. And then the south wind, then the wind turned completely south, and then that high tide's in the middle of the night, and I'm like, how am I going to have wash over here? I mean, these waves are pretty big out. This is a good swell. How washed over am I getting? Because I camp right as close as I can to, because you usually get that real good flat spot, and then it comes down.
Right.
So it's right on the top, you know, right where the top last high tide was. And so, but luckily, nothing, didn't have a great night's sleep, but I woke up, kept waking up looking for that, and then the wind shifted this morning to the west, and was supposed to die out, and
But it blew good for the morning.
Yeah, so I still couldn't get on the kayaks, and it was blowing, and it was still a swell out there, even the west wind didn't knock it down, it was still a swell, so I couldn't get in the kayaks, because this was all wavy inside here now. I'm like, okay, I'm just fishing from shore, I gotta leave at 10 anyway to make it in by noon to make it back to the ramp. You know, it was I had to make it in
because he had to be here for the podcast, which I was trying to miss.
I had to take the bus. I mean, the bus ends at noon,
right?
And if I don't get here, then I have all that against traffic coming against me the entire way through this channel, and then I also have a headwind now. You know, so I cruise. You know, and that. And a guy was asking me today about the 4.3. I camped out of that today, Lee, last night. I camped out of 4.3. So it's a lot smaller than the 4.7 because I had to take my shorter tent bedroll. I had to take my little tent, my shorter bedroll. Everything had to be scaled down to fit into this boat. But God damn, that fucking thing cruises. Once I get going on it, man.
Dude.
And then I shorten my paddle. If I have a head current, I'm sprinting, doing a little.
When I had that cobia in the boat with me, that thing paddled so amazingly. I mean, if I could put that kind of weight in the front and have that kind of weight in behind me, that thing would have been, I mean, it would have felt like a battleship. Just.
Dude.
It just carries so much momentum, dude. That 4.3. The momentum is insane.
The momentum is crazy. That's what's just amazing about it. 4.7, and I had well over 100 pounds besides me in that boat. And it paddled really
loud.
Awesome. Huh?
The seat is really
loud. Yeah. But it paddled awesome when I did the 4 days. I had 4 days with the gear on it. It was heavy, man.
Right.
Fucking heavy. And it just fucking glided. That's why I went all the way out to Watts that day. I just went. I just was like, I'm still, yeah. You know, muscle muscles felt great.
You're three quarters of the way and you could drift.
Yeah. Yeah, no shit. It was that much.
I mean, and people ask if it matters that much, and yes.
Yeah.
If you want to cover ground in open water,
and just it feels
that is paddle. That is what you want to do. If you, right. I mean, if you want to hop up and stand as fast as you can or whatever, the Trident is the way to go.
Yeah, but the more weight you have in the ultras, I can stand up with all my gear.
I don't carry any gear ever.
Yeah, and you can.
And I can.
But I can stand with all my
good balance. I surf my whole
life. With all my camping gear in it, it sits down really low and it feels like a Trident because it's sitting so low. You know, I can stand up and I feel pretty good. When the waves hit, it rolls a little bit because that primary stability will throw you a little bit. But yeah. So I couldn't fish this morning on the water. And of course, I would have to get on that side to look back because of the sun. Right, so I knew I couldn't get far enough, and it was just too wavy. It was just too much. So I was like, I'm just casting from shore. I know where they are. This is the area. So I just kept working that area, And I'm like, now I'm thinking, okay, it's getting close to time. Am I going to have to go back to the front way? You know, I might have to paddle 10 miles and then go another 3 miles to go try to catch a fish just to catch a fish today.
Right.
You know, or that was like, am I thinking that now? Because I would have time because I landed that. I landed that too. I mean, I was.
Oh, you want to come down here and then go catch a fish?
No, well, no, go down to near the ramp, and catch one. I was having to go down, then go out in front.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
Go down.
Yeah. So I was like, I'm already, you know, I didn't want to paddle that far today. I already paddled a bunch, you know. So look, I'm casting and I make one, and I must have put just. It was super lucky, you know, luck so much because I'm fishing. I'm casting in the
correct area.
I know that this is an area Red's going to be. This is where he loves
At
this.
Some point during the tide, he's going to come through.
Yeah, and it's just starting to come up.
Yeah. At some point during the tide, he's coming through.
And there's little baby sea clams all over the beach. Mm-hmm. And there's sheddings from calico crabs. They're right here.
Oh, yeah.
I'm really surprised they didn't get in schools. That's how beautiful that spot was. It was like, there's got to be a school sitting right here or roaming around this area, right? So I was making lobs out here. So I make one cast just, you know, half, you know, just outside right here on the edge of this breaker. And it must have just went right in front of him because as soon as I came tight, he was on. I was just like, thank you, because I just wanted to catch.
30-incher.
Yeah, another 30-incher. And from the beach, right?
Yeah,
so now,
yeah.
Now I'm surf fishing and I'm trying to pull back. And when I hook him, I run backwards. Because I'm hooking, I'm like, is he on? I'm just running backwards trying to get him.
Right.
Now he's on. Now, yeah, he's getting the pulls.
Dude, when I set the hook on a big drum in the surf, after that circle hook comes tight, I'm stepping backwards until, like, you feel that.
That's what I wanted because
pull you back forward and you're like,
because I wasn't sure in the kayak they immediately start and you start pulling, you start going with them, it's immediate tension's there. It wasn't a lot of tension because I was stationary, so I went like this, and if he turned at me, then you know it was weird. It was really weird. And then even landing him, you know, because I get him right there and it was weird because there was a standoff. Standing from shore, there's a standoff. I'm not used to it. I'm used to never stand off.
You're above them. It's a you are a sky.
And you're always moving.
You know what I mean?
You're always moving in the kayak, right? So I'm in a standoff, and it's like, this is weird. What am I? You know, I try to reel down and walk to him, and then he just go and pull that little bit of drag down. Just keep that little inch away from me. God damn! So it I'm like this is taking too long.
That's right, dude. On the pier, that's like catching him on the pier.
So then I get him up on a little wave, and I surf him in. And I take him and I put him in this little pool, and then I got to set up my pictures. I'm like, shit! I got this little, you know, I got a foam piece with my camera sticking in it, trying to get the shots of it. But I got one, and it was good because it was.
It was good.
Oh, this is. I haven't even posted that one up yet.
That's a different one.
Yeah, this one. I'm like. Mornings, no shirt on, just yeah, it was awesome. Yeah, and then I fished for a little bit longer, and then I had to come on in because I had to bring the bus, you know, take the bus in.
That's right.
But yeah, but it was just awesome being out in that environment again because it's been like 2 years since I've camped on that side. It's always been inside the bay. I go up to Pocomoke, and I love the Pocomoke Sound, but just these little beaches and now I'm like just huge, just monster, just huge. Yeah. I'm gonna post a picture up coming up of the low tide, and what I'm talking about with the divots and the channels and
yeah,
the was,
right.
I could barely get, you know, it's so big you can't get it with just standing there with the camera shot, you
right.
know. I mean, I got it, but just the detail.
You need that
texture,
drone, bro, for the camping.
That place is amazing. You'd be neat to really drone that place at low tide. Yeah, right. Yeah, because just the shoals and just the structure alone, and mm-hmm. I can see why. This is
you
where
see
Al
anything
goes.
Cool on your way in or out?
No, I didn't. I had a rod, my cobia,
right.
Rod for seeing if I saw one. You know,
right.
I'm in your area, and you were probably out there today. Yeah, were you out there today?
I was.
And,
it's on the seaside.
You know, I said I described him as big game fly fisherman. He's like, oh, I don't know about that. That's some bullshit. What the fuck? You just
the only time I've ever seen him
was
fishing for bull reds, and he posted a picture of
tarpon.
A jumping tarpon. The
tarpon.
Other day.
I wore a tarpon shirt today for this.
He posted a picture of a jumping tarpon. The
tarpon.
Other day. So have you landed one?
This year,
there.
Yes, one.
There,
that one, the one in the picture was landed,
and that was in this state.
Yes.
Yeah, correct. Virginia.
Awesome.
Two Virginia tarpon. Yeah. Awesome. Now, you know, yeah.
Yeah, I saw the picture. I mean, that is absolutely amazing. I've been over there in the kayak. Kevin and I gave like some attempts at a knot spot a couple times. And I've been over there 2 days in a spot. And the first day, after about 6 hours, we caught one. And it was probably 70 pounds or so.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was absolutely amazing. We pulled in the boat, took good pictures of it, got it mm-hmm. swimming good, it swam away. The next morning we went out, set up. A guy set up in front of us, plenty of distance. Set up in front of us, plenty of distance. Within 15 minutes, he had one jumping like crazy, and we had a rod scream. Just absolutely scream. And I picked it up. Blake caught the one the day before. I picked it up, man, and it came up to the top, and the giant splashes, and we swore it was her. And we came off the anchor, and we followed this thing around for 45 minutes or so. And got it up next to the boat, and it was 8 or 9 foot mm-hmm. of the ugliest shark everyone has seen. Time he goes up. I'm not a shark ID expert. It did not have a ridge in its back. It was that. I believe we had a big bull shark, but it was a big goddamn shark. Whatever the fuck it was big. I mean, big 8-9 footer. I mean. Big shark.
Yeah.
But that's what we caught that day. And then we got hung up in the mud going to look for another spot for about 2.5 hours.
Yep.
It happens. And that's going to happen. And if it doesn't happen, you are probably not in the right place or you're not looking for your own spots.
I mean, it's amazing. Even
you know what I mean? Like,
even in a kayak, I can run up on,
yep.
on a
oh, that
sandbar.
Place is
bloop.
Crazy,
just out
man.
Of nowhere.
And the fish we caught was in a really, really well-known spot. Mm-hmm. Really well-known spot. And then, like I said, we caught one. We came in the cove that morning, saw one roll, set up where we set up the day before. A guy set up 15 minutes and behind us, set up in front of us. I mean, just in sight. I mean, you know, what are you going to do? You know what I mean? The guy's plenty far away.
Right.
Plenty far away. So, just as beautiful as you want. He had one jumping. It was definitely her. I mean,
cool.
Released it. We talked to him later. He released that one. So,
mm-hmm.
So in 2 days over there in a good spot, I saw two released. We got one, and a guy that posted up right in front of us got one. And
that's better than
I didn't fill out a citation for that shark, and I should have.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
It was, oh my God.
Yeah, there were some huge.
Oh, yeah, oh yeah. This was, I mean, we're talking 300 or 400 pounds. That's why I think it was a bull shark, because it was that. I mean, it wasn't a long, skinny shark. It was a big, heavy, 8 or 9 foot shark.
What's funny is when I was stopping yesterday and today, when I was stopping to take a break and put my foot in the water, I was like, oh yeah, man.
No, you can't. All right, seal, bro.
I have a white sock because I'm getting the sun off. I got a white sock on.
That seal, though.
Dangling in the water.
Dead flipper. Like dying flipper up here.
Yeah.
Come get me.
Dead fish.
So how many years have you been targeting them on the Eastern Shore?
Everybody by now knows what we're talking about.
Yeah, tarpon. Twice, 3 times already. Yeah.
8 or 9 years.
Damn. When was it?
Right.
How long did it take you before you first had your encounter with one? had a encounter with one.
Depends on what you call an encounter.
I mean, how often did you see one roll? Well, did you see him roll as soon as you went over there?
No.
Because Rick saw the one we caught roll in front of us probably 20 minutes. I mean, I'm assuming it's probably the one we caught because it rolled in front of the boat 20 or 30 yards, and 15 minutes later we got a bite and it was, you know what I mean? We were hooked up. And we can only assume that this fish was just milling around, chilling, and found our bait.
I guess
the next day we saw one rolling on the way in, and a dude caught one in front of us, and that's it. That's it. I mean, people say you're going to see them rolling if you're in the spot. Well, I was in the spot, and we weren't seeing them roll. I mean, we were definitely in the spot because we caught one, and the next day a dude caught one in front of us.
I've seen them roll in the kayaks, and I've also seen one roll from the island south of where I camped last night, Myrtle.
Right.
There between, you know, on the south inlet, brushing my teeth at night, and one just goes... I mean, comes halfway out of water. This one, I'm like,
I saw the three off Sand Bridge like 7 years ago.
When you see them free jump, all of a sudden, just out of nowhere, you just be sitting over there, and one just comes up out of the water.
We actually saw one. I saw one in the spring, on the southeast side of the cut.
Mm-hmm.
There, actually,
just right come blazing right out of the water,
right in front of the clams that are on that north shoreline. Right there. I mean, right there, we were like, it jumped. It was like, was that what that was?
Right. It had to be that or a sturgeon, and it was probably that.
There was silver. I mean, it's shiny.
Yeah, it shined like crazy.
It was a bright
sun.
The
sun was hitting it. It shined like crazy.
Shiny.
Right.
Right. But I mean, it shot out of the water.
But it was so weird. It was like, this is not the spot. This is not even, no.
Right.
This is too
I mean, I saw three roll off Sandbridge one day, and I used a live bait off Sandbridge, right about 25 feet on the right side. I mean, the left side of me, I was looking over, and I mean, no doubt in my mind, they were 100% guaranteed tarpon. I saw their mouths, their eyeballs, their scales, their fins, and the little streamer thing. All three of them. It was two of them right next to each other and one right behind them. And then, like, about 15 seconds later, my bluefish goes click, click. You would have. Oh my God. I almost had a heart attack. The bluefish just. I don't know what it saw, but it wasn't a tarpon because I did not get a bite. But oh boy, wasn't like 15 seconds later, click click. I almost died.
How many summers did it take you before you saw one?
The first year I went 4 or 5 times, and I mean I was covering like since I got a flats boat, I was covering like 40 miles a day. And,
What was it?
Shane, could you two guys shut the fuck up and let the guy talk?
I'll tell you everything you want to know. Just stay tuned. I never saw any. I mean, I studied all the charts and looked at the maps and everything's like, well, this looks like a good spot. And if you, you know, those, ADC fish charts, you know, the old ones had little circled areas, and they had different species.
Right.
Well, if you can find an old one on the eastern shore, they actually have some tarpon spots located on.
Damn, that's in those are old maps too.
Because those are old maps.
I haven't seen one for the eastern shore in a long time.
So you need to find some. You need to find somebody that has an old one.
Yeah,
and look at that.
Yeah, but everybody's. Like,
oh, I mean, I've got some good area. I know some good areas now.
No, but just to have it right there on a chart like that is pretty cool.
But anyway, that's 100% accurate or not, but it's a place to start.
Yeah.
And I didn't see any for the first 4 or 5 trips, and I'd actually quit looking for tarpon, and it was actually in September, and I was speckled trout fishing when I saw some roll.
In September?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's still early. It's still hot.
Oh, yeah. That last September moon is, or that first September full moon or something is when they're supposed to hit the high road, man.
Right. Well, they hit the road before that, I think.
I mean,
think they go
normally the bite daylight. What I understand, the bite is better earlier in the season, and you see a lot more fish later, like on top. But that's just from the two people I know that have caught fish over there, and one of them caught a fish with me. We've caught several, but and that's Blake Hayden and Ken Neal.
Right.
And that's what they've said. The bites are more readily available early. There are a lot more fish to see later. is what they have said.
But they're all stuffed. There's so much food over there.
Oh my, right. Dude, literally go over there with squid and I mean, that's where people are filling coolers with.
Oh yeah.
I mean, croakers. I mean, they're walking across coolers. They don't have decks on their boats over there. they have North Carolina tags. And they don't have decks on their boats. That's how you know they're poaching them and selling them down south.
So you see them about five times over there, and you see them. Or
well, it took me five trips before I even saw any. And so the next year, I started at the spot where I saw them and started branching out from there. And I still didn't catch any.
Now you're totally targeting them fly.
Yes, right? Fly fishing.
And you're sight fishing. You're trying to see a goal.
Well, yeah, or blind cast to where I think there's.
Okay. So you're not just moving around. You're fishing.
But I will say that if you go there to fish with a plug or with a fly, if you're fishing in a big deep hole where you see some fish rolling, you're probably not going to catch one on an artificial. There's just, you need to find a different spot.
Right.
Like a shallower?
Shallower.
So you would have to, this is a high tide game.
Not 100%, no. Okay. Because they do spread out at high tide, but low tide they can be concentrated in holes.
Yeah.
But it depends on the hole. You know, some of those holes at low tide are still pretty deep, and if there's not many fish and if they're real muddy, and if you're talking about the fish being able to see a bait,
See, that's the thing, is the clarity over there.
It varies, like the
but
place.
But it's always a sand to it. It's never there really is, but clear. Like,
but if you get closer to the inlets, it gets clearer.
But with still with the sand mix, but it's muddy in the back. But it could be sand, like an ocean water sandiness. It's got that blueness to it, that greenness to it, but it still has got just a cloud.
Well, there are times when you can seal.
Damn. Like in the water.
Damn.
In the water.
Because I have only ever seen industrial thick, like, sludge over everywhere I fish.
Yeah, I mean,
literally industrial thick.
I mean,
I stood up
at straight noon and tried to look in the water. I was like, God damn. I mean, it was just, it would be hard. You have to see something on top. Like, that's the only way I would be able to see anything. Is that,
could be?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it's like when you see a cobia, it's on top, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
So, other fish can go on top.
Yeah.
You've seen reds on top?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I don't doubt it. I mean, and they see them in Florida. Although, did you see this picture the other day that Matt Lusk put up off of the Diamond Shoal area?
Was that down?
That's on the bottom on his GoPro, but that's a big school of tarpon right there.
Yeah, it is.
That's a big school of them. And he didn't get any bites. Or anything. He didn't even know what they were until he downloaded on a thing. But there was a school of fish down there, and they were big tarpon, and it was a bunch of them. That's a bunch of them. There's more of those things around in between here and there than there. Apparently, is a fire truck outside because the dogs are doing the ambulance thing.
All right, so you're starting to see him.
The third or fourth year, I was. Fishing in a hole where I'd seen some fish.
Third and fourth year.
That's right.
Okay, so
I've seen them and have not,
one. Touched one yet. You haven't jumped one, you haven't gotten contact.
Third or fourth year, I saw something out of the corner of my eye once and learned one of the first of the two secrets that I can't tell about the tarpon over there. But you have to get off the beaten path. And
you definitely have the rig to do it.
Yeah.
So these are places where, you know, kayaks would be great because you can go shallow. The only trouble with a lot of these places are probably more than a day in or out.
Right.
You'd either have to camp or mothership.
Right.
Yep.
Right.
Oh yeah. That's what we've always figured. That's why Kevin and I really haven't. We have not concentrated. We have some friends. I have Matt and Mike jumped seven one day.
Yeah, right.
Between the two of them.
And they camped out there.
They jumped seven of them one day.
Yeah. Right.
They didn't land a single one of them. But
They need to sharpen their hooks.
I think they were cutting corners on them or something like that. Were they fishing bait?
They had a couple fish break off.
Were they fishing bait?
Yeah.
Well, you need to have very sharp hooks.
I mean, they fish with the best.
I mean, need to sharpen your hook so it when you just touch it on your fingernail, it stops.
Yeah.
It's not going to move at all. And you need to check them during the day because as you're fishing, you run them through the sand and stuff and they get dull.
The problem with the kayak is, and I noticed this from the boat, we kept those reels slammed tight in the boat, and when that thing hit, he was fucking stung. Okay, in the kayak, you can put it as tight as you want, but if you do, it's fucking over. You know what I mean?
Well, also,
if he's going away, it's, you know what I mean?
Well,
and I'm talking about this rod tip almost hit the gunwale of the boat, and this fish was in the air, but it stayed tight. You know what I mean? And these guys jumped seven. That one or two of them stayed tight. Mike broke one off at some point.
Okay. So what he's talking about is when you hook, you immediately start to move.
Yeah, and so you're not holding your rod in the kayak. You've got it in a rod holder that's set in plastic.
It's not a stationary point is what you're saying.
Yeah, you're not, I mean, you're not absolutely driving the nail like you are when it's sitting that gunwale of that boat. And I mean, I know you catch them on the fly, so
you're sticking
hook setting.
Hit them hard.
Yeah.
I mean,
but that's the only thing I can think of is the reason that's the only reason I can give is that they didn't stay is because when I saw the one come tight on the boat, it was tight, like instant, like the rod almost hit the gunwale tight.
Well, there are a lot of reasons that they come off, and one is not having a sharp hook. Another one is if they eat when they're coming at you, their whole mouth is bone.
Yeah,
the hooks are going to want to slide right out.
Yeah.
And, so if you see the fish bite, which you probably don't with bait.
No.
But with a fly, you do. It takes nerves of steel, but you have to wait. If the fish is coming at you, you see it, you just have to wait for it to turn.
Right. Mm. Just wait.
So is there?
That sounds almost like a secret.
Is there a chance?
And then
is there
a chance?
Is there a chance for them to spit it? Or
no?
Or,
yeah.
If they don't feel the line, the tension.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. They'll eat it and shut their mouth and turn away.
When they're turning, I mean, when they do you like a circle hook? Do you just let it come tight, or when you come tight,
you let it come tight and then you hit them.
Multiple times.
The first thing they do is come out of the water.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the first thing, as soon as you hit it, the first time they jump, and but as soon as they come back down and they're swimming away, you hit them again.
Yeah.
And most people think that you can't put much pressure on a fish with a fly rod, and that's not really true. You can put as much pressure.
I mean, you've got what? You're fishing with a 50 pound or 70 pound leader. Or more. I mean, into the fish's mouth, I'm assuming you're probably using heavier than that. But I'm talking about into the fish's mouth, you're using heavy, like 80?
Yeah, 80.
Okay. I think we were using 100 with bait.
And I would actually recommend 100 because we've had fish chew through 80.
Right. I mean, that's. I think Blake fishes with 100.
I don't think that they're leader shy, so I think 100 is probably better.
Yeah. Oh, nothing could be leader shy in the water that we were in.
Right.
You're talking about a completely different water.
Right.
But nothing could be leader shy in the water we were in. I mean, we could have literally had 400-pound cable.
You could probably use wire.
Right. Oh, yeah. And that is the first thing that our fish did. It jumped before the rod even came out of the gunwale. The fish was in the air. It had jumped three times, and that was it. It swam on top a few times after that, but it never jumped again.
They usually jump about at least three, if not five or six times.
Ours jumped three. And it wasn't a big one, 70, 80 pounds, something like that. But
so is, for, when they jump, I've always thought this when I was in Florida and I fucked with some and of course with other jumping fish, when, you know, you bow to them.
Right.
Is it, if you have a boat rod that doesn't have a lot of give to it, and compared to a fly rod or a looser rod that has a give that you can still have, you know, tension, this maybe not be the same amount of tension as, you know, stiff tension as a boat rod, but have that tension to absorb those jumps. Is it better to have like a rod like that compared to a boat style rod where you're used to fighting heavy, you know, heavy fish with? with their jumps and their acrobatics.
If you are inexperienced with them, I would think something on the lighter end would be give you an advantage.
That's what I was thinking. Just because.
Yeah, you don't want to. If you,
it's
if
too. It's too.
There's too violent. Much. Yeah, they're too violent. Right.
For that stiff rod, because I mean, I'm fighting reds. I can feel every head shake. I can feel. And I don't know if I want to feel every head shake of a flying tarpon.
Do you ever measure your drag with a scale?
No, I haven't.
Okay.
I do it hand and...
Right,
and,
I do too. Yeah. But if you're just starting out, you might want to measure your drag with a scale, have somebody look at it while you pull, and set it like 3 pounds for a tarpon.
Well, when you're setting, are you like thumbing it when you're setting, or is it still at 3 pounds? You just keep
working. Well, actually, I usually am setting it with the line with my finger on the rod grip.
So you're thumbing it basically. Right.
Yeah.
Basically.
So I'm until I get the fish on the reel.
Right. And then it's 3 pounds.
Then it's. I actually used to have it set more like 5 now. But if you're learning, if you're not experienced, 3 would be better because it gives you more forgiveness in the jumps.
Yeah. Yeah.
And 3 is probably good with a conventional rod. And then after the first
3? Oh my goodness.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, you pull
oh yeah, we
3.
Fished mono, I know, but we fished mono for ours and we probably had our drag about like that, man. But I'm telling you, on those cobia that I fish for,
people come
we
up and pull
way
your
tighter than
and
that.
They, and they go like, God, this drag is so tight, but if you measure it, it's only a couple of pounds. I mean, when you talk about getting up to 15, 16 pounds of drag, I mean...
You're cutting into your hands.
You can't pull it off the reel with your hands.
The thing is, I have a reel that's 15 pounds of drag, and I have a reel that's 20 pounds of drag.
Right.
20 is too much in a kayak.
Right.
Straight up too much. But I have that max down. If a fish dives, if he's in deep water, I have to back off or I'm going over. That's the level. So I realize that it's 15 is most of I can go.
I have
that back down. I'm getting a ride. That's fine because you can still let some line out. But 20,
and you're giving when the boat moves too.
Yeah, yeah. Right. But when you go straight down, it's 15 because 20 is going over, or I'm letting go, or I'm going swimming, or I'm I've gotten to that limit with that. So I can see how 5 is probably that hand tight. We're probably
at
most of the time.
And tarpon will tire themselves out very quickly when they jump.
Yeah.
So after the first 3 or 5 jumps, you can increase the drag a little bit and really
fight them like a regular.
Get them into the boat. And they will jump if you, they will try to get air, especially when they get closer to the boat, if you keep the rod tip in the water, when they're close to the boat, when they try to roll, you pull behind them and down, keep them from getting any air. He'll give up a lot faster.
Yeah.
You don't want to give him a break.
Yeah.
And getting air.
Right.
You don't think about that with a fish. But you don't want them to get air. You know, if they're starting to come up and get a breath, you pull down and keep them from getting that, and they'll give up quick.
That's cool. I like that.
But they will chew through 80, so I would suggest 100. And they will hit a floating plug. I mean, if y'all are trolling over there with a swimming plug, they will... I've never caught one on one, but I guarantee they would hit that.
Well, that was
he would just have to swim behind you while you had it out.
Our friend Jay is trying to be, try to land one out of the kayak over there, and he's using artificials. He's trying to do it all artificial.
Yeah,
right. So he's caught some sharks on plugs before over there.
Yeah, I mean they will hit. We've
rattle trap or something.
We've probably had, and after the first 3 years was no fish. Fourth year, I think, learned one of the 2 big secrets, and we've started catching them since then. And
catching them, as in how many do you catch on average? How many do you catch a year?
I usually catch one a year. That's fly fishing.
Jump a year.
That depends. I almost jumped another one today, but it was my fault.
He took it, and you just didn't get it.
No, I spooked him.
Ah.
When you drop a lure on a fish's forehead,
they don't like it.
No matter what they are, they don't like that.
Even that light fly,
that was a little too close. The first cast was about a foot in front, and there was no reaction to that.
So I'll get a little closer.
So get a little closer, but too close.
See ya.
Got a great picture of it, though.
I mean,
I had 6 inches
from a cobia today. I mean, from coming from 10 feet, 6 inches. Nope. Sometimes I just don't want it.
But I think we've probably jumped 12, and I know we've landed 6
in
on a fly fishing in overall. 6 or 7 years. Now I missed a year. I did not get one last year because last year was sucked because it was too cold. We didn't get that many fish, and I missed one season because I spent so much time exploring the backcountry that I sucked so much sand and crud into my motor that it blocked the cooling passages.
Woo! Hot.
And I had to replace the power head. They couldn't clean it out.
Oh, so you were...
I missed bogus. The whole season over there for that. But the good thing I will say is the company that made the motor... The motors are so they've been so good that they didn't even stock power heads in the U.S. because they never blow. So it took them like...
You got a Suzuki, right?
No, it's a Merc.
Merc, oh.
But it's a Tohatsu Merc. It's a small, it's a 25. Okay. So it's Tohatsus are great motors. I don't get paid to say that. I paid a list price for the motor. But it took them like... 5 months to get the parts, and they actually felt so bad that it took them so long that they covered the cost.
Damn.
So I lost a season, and it was my fault. I mean, I told them, it's like, hey, I run through,
you know, right,
everything. Damn. And they said, well, that's obvious, but so you know, that's the reason the people don't give more details about this is because most people that catch those fish over there have really had to pay their dues.
Yeah.
And they don't want to give it to anybody.
My buddy Blake's dad lives there. His grandparents grew up over there. I mean, he's fished over there his whole life. And I got lucky enough to fish with him the one time I was actually in a spot to fish. You don't even recall one.
Right.
But yes. And he's the one, like I said, he's the one that taught Ken Neal. Ken Neal chartered him several times as the one that, you know, he is legitimately one of the guys, one of the youngest guys that has more knowledge over there.
Right. So, I mean, nobody gave me any pointers at all. I just started from zero and...
from a chart that had a circle on it.
Well, actually, that chart... Most of the fish we've caught have not been in places.
But like you said, it would give you,
it gives you a place to start.
And ideas to look for and all that stuff. Yeah.
And we they're not all in one place. I mean, we've landed them in three different spots. Probably had bites in 4 or 5 different spots, and I've seen them in other spots.
I've heard
we haven't. You know, it just like any fish. I mean, sometimes you'll see them you'll see them laid up.
Yeah,
and the laid up fish are probably just napping, and even though you can see it, it's probably not going to react until you spook it. I mean, you can go right up to them and you can drop everything in front of its face, and it's not going to move until you touch it.
Hmm.
You can go up and stick it with your rod, and then it's going to blow up.
We got to find these spots.
Well, see, that's what's it, that, that.
But if you
that,
find if you
it makes out, it more interesting because you can see them. That's the thing.
That's what I'm saying.
It's been bait fishing over there. I'm like, I'm really bored of that.
Bait fish.
As long as there's a sighting, as long as there's an interaction. There's an interaction.
Yeah, I don't have any interest.
You know what I mean? Sight casting. Right. That's a lot.
When you find one that you can tell is actively feeding, then you're good to go.
Yeah.
The laid up ones, not so much. Sometimes they're just cruising. And they don't always roll. Sometimes you'll come upon fish that you have not seen roll. All of a sudden, there'll be some fish there.
Well, that's just like the one I saw a couple of years ago. That's not a spot for him. I mean, that's he was just moving in, right?
Right.
He looked like he was just coming in with the current. He was just
cruising
on in, but he was still further south than usual spots, man.
Right.
You know, and from there, he has to go. A lot of weird way to get to where the usual spots are.
I mean, they're
so it can be anywhere, you know. I've heard of at least 6 different spots, and that's varied all around that area. It's not one area.
There's so much habitat over there.
Yeah.
That area. I mean, I probably covered 40 miles today.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until the last spot where I saw 3 fish. The first spots are places I've seen fish before. In fact, the first spot I went to is a place where I caught my first one.
Yeah.
On a fly, and I didn't see one fish there.
Hmm.
Didn't see one roll or anything. So
yeah. They could be...
There's just so much territory. I mean...
It's vast.
It's extremely vast. And then when those fish spread out like that, I mean, there could, you know... But Bob Hutchison, you know, the former outdoor writer for the pilot, he says about 350 have been caught since the 1950s that he knows of. He keeps pretty close tabs. He thinks 9 or 10 have been caught this year so far.
That's about average.
And you've caught one.
That's one of those of mine. He knows he's included.
Right. Yeah. And you caught one of them. That's insane. You catch them on the flies, man.
But if you fish with the bait, I mean, I fished with bait. I got nothing against bait fishing, but I got nothing against shark fishing. But if you fish over there with bait,
you're shark fishing.
That's why
your bycatch is going to be a tarpon.
That's why it's bycatch.
That's
why we get over it.
You're stingray and shark fishing over there.
Oh, we've tried chumming twice.
But no, I wouldn't do that over there.
I wouldn't even think about that.
No. Oh man, I mean,
I don't even like to throw.
You talk about
when the sharks eat my whole baits in half. I hate even throwing that chunk of bait back in the water because I know it's just going to chum more sharks.
Right.
Like I hate throwing. I try and throw it towards the shore. You know what I mean? Like, it's just that. When the sharks eat my whole baits in half, and
if you want to go shark fishing, go out there on some marsh point, some edge of some flat over there where it drops into a hole and starts chumming.
Right.
Bring them all there.
And you'll catch
them. I mean, you're going to catch the one you want. Just give it a little bit of time. You're going to catch the one you want.
Probably come up to the chum bucket so you get to pick the one you want.
Oh, I had a bait dangling in the water that was just trying to keep alive, and a little baby shark like this came out and started nibbling that. I was like, come on! You know, just... It was alive.
Oh, they got them all sizes over there. They come from like this big...
to humongous.
To the one that gave birth to it like 10 years ago.
The tarpon do that too. We've seen them as small as like that big.
Really?
Yeah.
See, that's the thing. I didn't know if there's any small ones. I've always heard
only one though that big.
But what about medium size, 40 inches and
four? You know,
a few.
Hardly ever hear that.
It seems to me that there have been less fish as the years go by.
Really?
But that they're getting bigger.
Less fish.
I mean, it kind of is frustrating because the first couple years when I didn't, but actually the first couple years that we found fish before we figured out what flies and how to catch them, we would see a lot more fish those years than like I have this year. So it's kind of like, gosh, if I had known then what I know now, I'd be catching a fish every trip.
It's just like striper.
But
we don't have a striper anymore. We got all these techniques.
But I mean, we have seen some gigantic tarpon over there. And we've jumped some that are easily 130, 140.
Mm-hmm. And you've seen them bigger than that.
Yeah, big.
I mean, when you're in the boat, and
the fish is like, and you see one roll like 30 feet away, and it's like half the size of your boat, you're like, you know, I need a bigger rod. It's like, I don't want to hook that fish.
But how long does it take?
The real big ones can't get their whole body out of the water when they jump. Because they're just
too big,
too heavy. So they come like halfway up.
How long do they take to catch on the fly rod?
5 to 20 minutes, depending on
fish how many jumps. 20 minutes on the bait, it probably took 20 minutes.
5 to 20 minutes, depending on if you...
How excited the fish is, and it comes right up next to the boat.
And it comes down to the angler, if the angler knows how to keep them from getting a breath and how to put pressure on a fish.
See, but the more
at
jumps,
our fly fishing
less,
club, yeah, the more they jump, the quicker they get tired. And then, you know, go outside to the fence or something and tie your 20-pound tippet to the fence and go back to your rod and see how hard you can pull before you can break that. I mean, you can pull really hard.
Right. So and you're lying, you're people, fishing with an 80-pound...
Even though you have a fly rod, if you don't put a bunch of bend in it, if you fight from the butt, you don't want to bend the rod more than that much.
It's not like a big spinning rod, but you can like to get the parabolic action.
Once you get, I don't know,
45 and tight.
once you get when you've got your rod all the way up here and bent like that, you're not putting any
pressure. No. I'm not talking about high sticking, but you're not trying to.
Well, yeah, you do, but you know, you don't get it. Don't bring it much higher than your waist.
And you're dealing with like 12 feet instead of I'm dealing with 6 and 7. Right.
So you can, you know, a lot of people don't realize. Anybody listening, go tie your 20-pound tippet to the fence.
And try to break it.
And
try to break it.
And goes and see how hard you can pull before you can break it. Yeah. You can pull.
So is that what you're? So I don't exactly know what a fly line consists of, other than I know your backing is generally like really good braid. Or do a lot of guys use the JB hollow core?
But any kind of braid.
Any kind of braid for your backing. So you got what, 50 or 60 back there for tarpon fishing?
Yeah. Something like that.
50 or 60. Your actual fly line, I don't care whether it's sinking or whatever, I'm not going to ask that. But the strength of it, what kind of strength do you have there? Or does it not come in strength?
It does. The strength depends on the core. And they're 20, 30, or 40 pound.
Okay, so you're not going from 50 to 80. You're going like 50 pound braid back down to like a 30 or 40 pound line. Okay, and then a tippet is what's on the end of your fly line that goes to your leader.
Yeah, sort of.
see?
If you're fishing under IGFA rules, like a line class, like you want to catch a 20-pound tippet. Yeah. Record tarpon, the tippet is the weakest point in your fly line, and it has to be a certain length. And you're allowed to have what they call a shot tippet, which is the last 12 inches or so right at the fly, which can be heavier for fish with teeth and like tarpon. So,
right, so you can
if
be 12
you were fishing
inches
an IGFA leader for tarpon, you would have a 20-pound leader, you'd have 20 pound tied to a little
and
piece.
A tippet is not 20 pound test monofilament, though.
The tippet would be the 20 pound, and the bite, the shock, what they call it, the shock would be
your 80.
Would be the 80, would be a foot of 80.
Okay. I mean, that's plenty for a mouth of a. I mean, even when you're getting to the biggest fish, if you hook them where you really need to hook them, you don't.
Yeah,
you know,
but they will,
foot.
You know, the other thing about tarpon is though they will jump and land on the leader and break it.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's true.
So, unless you're fishing for a record, I wouldn't.
Just by the idea of
fishing. I wouldn't.
So you don't do the tippet thing. You just have.
I use a couple of feet of 30 and then 2 feet of 80 maybe.
Right.
We're trying to catch them. You still want.
We're trying to catch them. That's right. That's what I mean.
Yeah, but
I'm
still
a big
want
fan
to be able
this.
To. I still want to be able to break it off if something happens, big shark starts chasing it or something. I still want to be able to grab and lock the wheel and break it off.
Yeah.
Lock the reel and.
Have you seen big sharks chase tarpon that you have had hooked?
Not in Virginia, but I've seen them do it in other places.
Yeah.
And I've seen sharks in Virginia that are big enough to eat the tarpon.
Oh my! The one I caught could have eaten the shark. The tarpon.
I have
we
not seen it
before.
Happen, but
Yeah, I was wondering if that happens. That happens in Florida. The Boca Grande's become a spot where the sharks are coming there to eat the tarpon that are the anglers are catching and releasing. I mean, that wonder if that will become. These sharks will start to learn that around here and start to kind of.
You know, I don't think. I think that this. I think that if.
It's not.
That I think active. If there was that many people fishing for tarpon over there, that the tarpon fishery would collapse before
that. Like the Boca Grande one, because that is a million. That's all that attraction brings the sharks in.
And
all that noise.
A lot of those people are. I don't know if you're familiar with the jigging technique they were using there.
With the weights or something like that?
Yeah, they were basically they're using a jig.
That the weight separates off of
where
a little tiny
the weight breaks
bait.
Off, and they were you know they'd mark a school of tarpon and they're jigging, and they hook a tarpon and
they
hook
a tarpon.
The people say that you know more than half of them are just snagged.
Oh,
they're not really biting; they're just snagged. So there's been a big deal in Florida to outlaw that.
That technique,
because it just kills the fish.
Yeah, bleeding fish and sharks.
Right.
That gets the rest of their bodies under attack.
Yeah. I'm surprised that you haven't seen that happen. That could happen over there.
Right, there's sharks, man.
There's big enough sharks over there they can take out.
I don't want to encourage people to fish for tarpon over there because you really have to pay your dues. And if you're not obsessed with it, you've either got to be really lucky. And I was obsessed. It's like, you know what? I'm going to do it. I'm going to catch one.
That's exactly what I tell people about that. And they come to me, or you probably like, well, yeah, I tried 1 year, and I was like, I'm good. There's a lot more fun stuff to do.
Right.
For me, there's a lot more fun stuff to do than this.
Right.
You know, you have to, just like chasing expert angler wasn't fun. You know,
right.
But I was obsessed to do it. And
right.
Like the cobia for you now. You're not even having fun.
Not having fun with it, and now I'm just doing it when it's time. Like, now it's time to go hunt those pilings. I'll do it, and on those nice, calm days, I'll go out as far as I can, and I'll do it. I did it last year. It was fun.
Right.
You know, just paddling around looking, but I'm not going to go obsessive with it because then that's not fun.
You have to become what you saw today.
You have to become obsessive to do the tarpon over
there. Yeah. That was the only thing I did, and you know, I quit fishing for Kobe and everything else in June and July, and the first 2 weeks of August, all I did was tarpon fish.
Yeah.
So any chance I had to fish, that's all I did.
Yeah.
But it's paid off now,
and
it's fun.
That's what it takes.
But that's what it took.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
I mean, if you go over there once or twice a year, you might get really, really lucky.
Good luck.
That's right. And if you're afraid to run aground, you're not going to, it's not going to happen. I mean, that's a good thing about over there. People go over there and they run aground once or twice and they give up.
Yeah.
So, it's not.
Yeah, or the bugs. Most people
or the bugs. The flies.
It's fucking terrible, man. It's really, flies. Really bad sometimes. It's really bad.
They were,
I had 2 inches.
Shoes that had these, like, mesh on them, and they're biting me through the mesh.
Yeah.
They're like, it's like flies. I got shoes on, man. That's some biting me through the shoes.
Yeah. The one thing, you know, I need to do a video of how, because each species of biting bug out there has its own way of killing it.
Right.
You notice that? Like horse flies, you have to wait till they open up and start drilling
right
before you hit them, because otherwise you can't if they just land on you and try to go for them, you can't get them.
Right.
And you can't do this to them either, because they'll go out to the sides and shit. They're really fast.
Right.
So you actually have to wait for them to start to work and then smack them.
Right.
The beach flies, house flies looking mm-hmm. ones that bite the fuck out of you, you can't smack those. You have to be either really on you, and you have to be really lucky to smack them. The way you do those is above them. You have to hand clap above them because they take off straight up. It's the only way to get them. I've lived out on beaches.
Right.
I know how to kill everything out there. Right? And you know, those are the two main ones because those are the most crafty.
Right.
Like, those are the ones that are also going to get you in the wind. They can hunt in the wind. Horse flies can go in 15. They can hunt 15 miles an hour, and they gang up in pairs. And they'll also, another thing about horse flies, if they'll land, like this last week, I got one, I'm doing fucking yoga out there, and one lands on me, and I miss, and he lands on my boat, and I see him, and I watch him, and he won't move until I move. As soon as I move, he comes at me, and I fucking go him again, I miss him, and he lands, and I'm watching him again, and they will actually watch you until you start to do your other thing, and they'll
distracted.
Fucking, they'll wait till you turn away, if you swat, and then it's amazing. It's amazing they're on contact. They're actually on contact with you.
Right.
That frustrated me more than anything. It was like, these motherfuckers are waiting for me to turn my back and then go right on my knee pit. They're right in my knee pit as soon as I turn my back on them. It was crazy. So, yeah, I need to do a video of how to kill all the
beach
bugs.
That is a good idea.
Because that is one of the things that stops people from the eastern shore is the bugs. But
right.
You know, somebody like me, I'm like, I'm all right with it.
Right.
I've dealt with so much worse.
Yeah.
But
been bit before.
But it is pretty bad when you're lit up with horse flies on your legs and your whole leg starts to vibrate with that venom.
Right. and when they I had one get me on the hand today and it left like a slit.
Yeah. Yeah.
That guy was sawing.
At the very end of the first DVD, I have like the end reel thing.
Mm-hmm.
I have one of close up that's actually, I let him bite.
Right.
And you can see his mouth open up and the drill come down.
Right.
And it works its way in, and it's slender. So
right.
It's like a blade.
Right.
So it works its way in, and then it pulls that, and you can see the blood pour out.
Right.
And then he opens up another spot and starts drilling in, and then I kill him. But that they have this drill, and it is a slice. And I had one stuck on me, and I didn't know he was there. They sometimes get between nerves, and that's the weirdest part.
Yeah.
Like some bugs can get. I don't know if they just get in between where they can't. They fit in there where you can't feel it at all, mm-hmm. right? So he was on my hip, and I just went like this, and it was blood. I was like, shit, he had been on me for a long time just working. Oops. And he had like gotten stuck on there or something, and I distracted him, and I just went like that and killed him. But yeah, those are bad. And I think it's cool because that discourages a lot of people from that area.
Right.
And the running aground, you see, when I was tarpon fishing that year, I'd see him just run up. And it was high and dry for a long time, and that'll stop people.
Yeah, in fact,
the distance.
2 weeks ago, I'm
vastness
heading out of Oyster, and there's a guy from Carolina running hard to ground there. And I wasn't sure if I could get him off, but we got him off.
Oh, yeah,
because the tide was falling, and I said, "You got one shot here, and are you going to be?"
Here for the next
6 hours. Hope you got some
hours.
Food and some water.
It would definitely happen over there. It happens quick.
And he was, you could tell he was really embarrassed. He's like, well, I've been here before. I didn't know him.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the day markers over here don't mean a whole lot, but you are on the wrong side of this.
All right. Yeah.
There's a couple over there. There's a couple green markers over there that are completely back in the marsh now. Have you ever seen those?
No, is it so?
I'll have to get you a picture of those. Because a lot of the channels are migrating west, and the old day markers that are in with a piling, I mean, the channels move so far that the marsh is, they're sticking right up out of the marsh.
The marsh, that marsh is actually growing up around it.
Yeah.
Huh.
And when it's low tide, not only is it marsh, but there's like 30 feet of mud flat.
Yeah.
Before the channel. So, I mean, the day markers are like, some places are way off.
There was one used to be on Paramore that the shoal had worked its way, and it was like right in the middle of a shoal.
Right.
Sand on the beach shoal. I mean,
right.
Marker.
Yeah. And they just see the PVC pipes, but you never know what those are. They could
claims!
It should be claims. Sometimes they're marked with the red and green. Sometimes today, the guys have marked them. And that was a channel. That was the main channel, and it came to a point where I ran aground. started hitting. I was like, damn.
I would suggest exploring over there on the rising tide.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was our mistake.
Yeah.
We got hung up over there.
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess I was hung up like 2 hours.
If you want to drop out of there fast, if you're in a place that...
It's big over there. I forgot how big the tides are. Last night and this morning, I was like, shit. I mean, it's huge. I mean...
When that water starts to drop, you need to resist the temptation and...
Make a move.
Yeah, I know. And
that's why
I went when I did today, because if I didn't, I was going to have all that against me. And that would have made my day really, really bad.
So have you ever seen like a bunch of them at one time? Like a school of them? Or like four or five? You know what I mean? Just like cruising together.
I've seen more than four or five in one spot.
But usually individual.
But not individuals. Not
what I would... call a school.
Not like with the picture I just showed you before. I mean, that was a school of fish. You know what I mean?
And it's weird because, you know, you hear of the schools coming up the coast. Like, I've got some friends that fish out of Harker's Island a whole lot down there, Cape Lookout. And they see the schools migrating north and then migrating south. They'll see a school of 20, 25 tarpon rolling happily down off the beach.
Yeah.
But when they get up here, they seem to...
Individuals.
They seem to spread out, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Now, they might still be in schools outside the inlets, but I'm not sure.
Hmm.
Right.
I've never really fished out there much, but that the...
those shoals out in front of those inlets are wild.
Big reds and those things.
I think that the state record, the 130-pound fish caught by Barry Truitt, I think that was actually caught in the ocean outside an inlet.
Yeah.
I don't think he's caught plenty of fish on the inside, but
right. I mean,
I think he actually caught
the ones I saw looked really nice. I don't know what a tarpon weighs. The ones I saw on Sand Ridge that day looked like pretty amazing fish. You know, I would say they probably were 70, 80 pounders. Yeah. You know, not giants.
I think the average over there is probably 50 to 90, but there are some big fish over there.
Smart, old, big fish over there.
Yeah, and these are migrating up from, and I guess from Florida, because there was a tag that was popped off, a satellite tag popped off from Sandbridge from a tarpon that was, I guess, working its way up.
Yeah, they migrate up here from somewhere in Florida and go back.
Crazy. Just come up here and eat some croaker.
Yeah, they come up here, spend
two or 3 weeks. They're literally up here to eat croaker.
Eating croakers and crabs.
Yeah.
They're following the Carolina people up here to get the croakers.
Right. Croaker chippers.
I mean, dude, down in Carolina, the where they catch the giant tarpon, amazing croaker bites too.
Right.
You know what I mean? That whole Neuse River Basin area there, they croaker fish the heck out of that.
Well, it'd be hard to really tell. I mean, how many the catch ratio to how many croaker, if there's a good year of croaker, how much?
I don't know.
You know, whether there's any kind of correlation with those two.
They might just be following the croaker schools out in front of the inlet out there, just in the ocean.
Did you hear about the one that was the tarpon that had gotten into the pound net that was off of Chicks Beach?
No, not this year.
No, a couple years ago.
Oh, okay.
A couple years ago, one had gotten in there and eaten up all the spot, like wiped it all out. Got in there, just ate, and I think they pushed it down enough and raised it up where it jumped out. It just got out.
Wow.
Yeah.
I've heard of them being caught in pound nets and other places in the bay. In fact, one was even caught up in Mobjack Bay one year.
Wow.
In a net.
Huh.
But you don't hear of them in the bay too often.
Yeah, yeah.
But they did catch one up there one year.
Someone said they thought they saw one at HRBT one night. But they were like cruising. Like a 40, 50 incher, you know, one of those, I guess.
Could be. I've heard rumors of them in the years past being in the hot ditch.
Hmm.
But,
You ain't gonna find one of them anymore.
Yeah, that's not pretty. Salinity in there wouldn't be enough for them.
No, they can live in fresh water.
Okay, man.
Yeah. Hmm. In fact, they
they do in the rivers down in Central America.
The juveniles. That's how they survive. They
go up river.
They go way inland where it's brackish or fresh, and actually where there's such limited oxygen, because they can breathe oxygen out of the air, they'll go back in there where it's totally stagnant and nothing else can live.
Yeah.
And they're just sitting there and eat insects and stuff, and there's no predators, no other fish.
Well, what? There's not enough oxygen. Only predator is shark for them, right? I mean, that's...
Well, when they're young...
They got birds.
They're bait, dude. They're minnows. Shiners.
Shiners.
Until they get 40, 50 inches, you're just a shiner.
When they get big, it's pretty much just sharks.
Yeah.
Like, I'm pretty sure you could take, like, a 12 or 14-inch tarpon and rig him up for a fucking blue marlin bait. Sure. You know what I mean?
Shiny though.
Right.
Man. So you kept one, at least one a year.
Except for the... I did not get one last year.
Because of the boat problems.
There was one year I missed because of the boat problems, and I did not get one last year because I think too cold.
How many, on average, do you jump? How many do you get unhooked?
Doing pretty good. I mean...
The ratio?
We're probably 50-50, like, out of...
That's not bad.
No, out of every two jump, get one of them in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, you're using a single really sharp hook, and since you can see the bite, you can judge on setting the hook in the opposite direction. If the fish is going this way, you can set the hook this way. If the fish is going that way, you can set the hook that, you know, so you're getting more of a backwards. I mean,
when
the fish is eating bait, you know, you just get a blind bite down there, you don't know what direction the fish is heading or anything.
How big is the lure size? I mean, they can handle a croaker that big. I mean, are you going small?
Yeah, or big. We use big.
Big, so you can see.
Yeah.
Yeah. Flashiness?
No flashy. Big, dark colors.
Mm. Yeah. That color of that water is a
right.
Light,
yeah.
Real light. Yeah. Sandy.
No flash.
big dark colors.
They're like not, apparently they're not.
3-0, 4-0 hooks, something like that. I know in Florida they like to use small hooks, but we've had good luck with big hooks, so.
Yeah.
3-0, 4-0 is big hook to you?
Hmm?
I catch cobias on 10-0.
Yeah, no. We're talking about tarpon.
I catch cobias on 10-0 circles. Okay.
I'm not talking about cobia hooks.
Cool.
Wow, this is awesome,
man. Yeah, that's so crazy.
And but we just talked about tarpon. We need to, like, we've literally watched you drum fish.
Yeah.
So we, I mean, what time?
Well, the tarpon fishing is different. It's
We gotta wrap it up.
We gotta wrap it up. So
okay.
You definitely have to come back.
All right. Well, because tarpon are the best fish.
Right.
Because they are, you can sight fish them. They are big. They are extremely strong, and I love redfish, but redfish don't jump.
Mm-hmm.
And they're even audible because, you know, when they jump, they shake their heads, so their gills.
You can hear it.
That thing is what impressed me when I jumped mine in right. Florida. That was the thing that really lasted with me, is that sound of bones
right.
rattling. It right. sounded like bones shaking in
right.
a bag.
So, yeah. I mean, you get
that
it.
That was amazing.
They feed every sense you have. You can feel it in your hands. You can see it. You can hear it.
Well, now I know I'm going over there, you know, when I'm going camping and stuff, and just going with something that floats, something that's dark, and trying to find something with a little bit looser rod so I don't get yanked out of my boat like that. So no, if that thing goes jumping, it's going to yank the shit out of the rods that I have. Yeah. Yeah. And just keep my eyes open. Look for...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Look for
I mean, I can't really cover a lot of area.
Well, you are the best sight fisher I know. I mean, you see fish that I've never seen.
Right.
You know, if anybody could...
Oh, I'd love for him to get on the boat and ride with us in the tower
yeah.
one day.
Yeah.
It would be amazing if he came out there in the middle of the bay when it's good.
Right.
And I might try and talk him into it in the next couple of weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Coming out in the afternoon with me and Jay one day and just let him ride around in the tower and just
right.
point him out. We just cruised through the fucking bay and ocean and
the first
like
time
vacuum.
The first time I went on a boat with him and Rick's boat.
Right.
And on the pilings, and I was just like, I was, there they are. There's one.
Right.
Yeah, I was seeing him. There's one. And they were like,
I'm like looking
right.
at
yeah.
spade fish.
Cobia.
All right.
Oh, there's one.
The big cobia I caught, the 67 pounder on the video, I was staring at spade fish again. I was like, oh, there's a big cobia there. What? Turn around.
Yeah. So we didn't even get, especially in the springtime. We definitely can come in the springtime after we fish with you over there. And,
yeah.
Because that's something that we all kind of do together over there. It's cool when I see you in the mornings. I'm like, all right, he's going to be out here. So, yeah. And I don't have a phone by then. I don't have a phone now.
Just living it.
I'm going up to Ocean Kayak. I'm going to go up to Maine, so I need a phone to go travel. I'm going up there for the Trident stuff. Yeah, so I need a
the
phone
Trident
for that.
Stuff?
Yeah, the Trident upgrades they're doing for the Trident.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I'm going to see what
nice.
They're doing and do all that stuff.
Nice.
But,
when is that?
It's a couple weeks from now. Sometime in August. Sometime this month.
They hear.
What's that? Kobe? Yeah.
No.
What?
I've seen a lot of pictures of them near islands, man. It's time to start jigging.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We just got to get out there. They're not, we're not going to catch 7 or 8.
Yeah.
But they're there. Because
it's
I've seen
fall,
lots of pictures of them.
The fall when
they're
around
near,
them.
I've seen a lot of pictures of them near rocks already.
Yeah. And I have
enough
two.
To rocks that we
I
can catch
two.
Them.
I have two, yeah.
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 It's time to start getting that way. I told Jay today, I was like, man, if we don't catch any fucking cobias on the way out, I was like, if we don't catch any cobias, man, it's worth it just to drift down the edge of those rocks with these bucktails. And it didn't take us 5 minutes and we had one on. So, a cobia. So, we didn't go drum fishing.
I think must have reset or something because it's like.
Did we go over?
No. We don't. I don't have a time limit on it. I like to try to keep it at an hour and a half.
Yeah.
Because that's we've done hours an hour before, an hour and a half is about right. And but yeah, something happened where it maybe dropped out. It's still working there, but yeah, still recording that one. That's what matters. But yeah.
No viewers.
Two. We went from we had about 15 earlier.
Ah.
Yeah.
Nice. We started cutting them off.
Let's all start talking. They all
about
9 o'clock is when everybody started kind of dropping out.
Yeah, I'm ADD. That'd be too long for me. An hour would be max for me.
All right, well, that's it then.
Yeah, man.
Here we are. This is awesome, man. We can do it again anytime.
Yeah. Because, especially in the spring coming up, because that's fun fishing with you over there, like I was saying.
But yeah. Yep. All right, thanks to our sponsors, Yak Attack at yakattack.us, and check out my DVDs at kayakevin.com, and later.
H2O Outdoors.
And VCFA.org, Virginia Coastal Fly Anglers.
Yeah.
That's the club. All right. Later, y'all.